So thanks again for joining us, friends. Today we have with us Pratyush with us. Pratyush, would be good if you could quickly introduce yourself. I know you have been a stalwart in the market, but it'll be good for I think these participants also to hear a bit from you.
Thanks, Amir. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this session. I'm from the lending industry. I spent almost 21 years in the lending industry, worked with various organizations in risk and fraud management, product management, business development, and I've been also working with a lot of you in the market, where we are kind of providing the alternate database solution and the technology solutions. So looking forward to the session and talking about more and more digital adoption, what is happening in the industry, and what we are doing as well, and some of those key changes which has happened with the recent regulation in terms of the video KYC. So look forward to the session. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Pratyush. And over to you, Ajay. Over to you, Ajay.
Okay. Namaskar. Welcome to this event. I have been working with Fero FinCorp over now 8 years. Worked in NBFC and bank financial services more than 20 plus years. Been throughout retail financing, lending business, from 50,000 to 50 lakh kind of a ticket size been managed, various product lines. And deep rural territories, onboarding customers who are underserved. This is where I am, and would like to participate in this event along with all the wise men which we are looking on the screen, and to share my experience.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Ajay, for your support. I think good to have your, I mean, while we may be practitioners in the market on the outside perspective, but I think inside out is always good, because gyan kitna bhi hota hai, but jo implement karta usko pata hota hai ki kis kya sach hai kya jhoot hai, right? Isse KYC karna chahiye, then you suddenly realize, oh, this regulation, this rule doesn't work, and therefore we have a challenge. And I'm sure sometimes RBI audits teach us more than anything else, right? So it's a mix and match. Happy, extremely happy to have both of you here. Thank you, guys. Thank you. So with this, I mean, just quick 2 minutes before we start, I think many of you know us. I'm Sameer Singh Jenny, and I'm part of the Digital Fifth company. Now, in terms of work which we do, I think one thing which I didn't realize, and I'm just explicitly telling today, that I didn't realize that maybe we are world's largest fintech training company. May not be the largest on the consulting side, but the largest on the training side. That's something which we just realized, that maybe that's what we are. But anyway, overall, we work only on the digital and BFSI overlap. Nothing else we do. We work a lot on consulting side, so CDO as a service, CTO as a service, and we sort of run strategy and activity for many, many people in the market, large and small, and very large and very small entities both. We work a lot on partnership side, on the fintech partnership between a bank and fintech and or any other framework side. We do tons of training on open banking, fintech, and stuff like that. And of course, we do hire as well, only in the selected domain on fintech, and we don't go beyond that. From September onwards, right now we are training almost 45 guys in very senior guys in the fintech, open banking, and financial blockchain sessions. And we also have back-to-back trainings coming up. So would be happy to have you out there. And with this being the case, maybe what we will move forward is the agenda itself. And maybe a quick discussions on what we need to do, what are the new regulations, what are the new trends emerging. So we'll talk about it in this session itself, and sort of gain your guidance on that. So that is the overall agenda, and what we will do is we'll spend around 40-45 minutes in the question and answers. But of course, in the process itself, we will also take your questions and try to embed them in the journey as well, so that if there are any queries, to keep raising. I'm actually reading those queries as well, and we'll sort of act upon it. So with this, the first question itself, that pandemic has impacted a lot, right? Last year we were saying what will happen post-COVID, right? Maybe it's not a right terminology, because there is no post-COVID. It is present continuous, right? So I think I want to know what is happening on the digital lending side, what is happening in the market overall, and what do you see in the future? What is the future gazing you have? So Pratyush, what do you? A quick guidance on digital lending as you see, and what is the future ahead for us?
Thanks, Amir. Okay, so some great question, and and in fact, we have been dealing with this day to day. So a lot of things which has changed in the last couple of years, in my view, while financial services has always been focused upon adopting newer and newer technology, using the data, whether it is traditional and alternate. And I think these are the two things which is actually keeping them differentiated from their peers. And that is the only way one can really make a progress. However, this has not been done considering that there was no environment, there was no early adoption of these technology and alternate data. But I think the last couple of years when we have gone through the pandemic crisis, we can clearly see that there has been a lot of focus in technology adoption and using how you get more and more data about your consumer so that you get more and more insight. So clearly two or three things which is coming out as a trend, and when we are working with many of our partners, many of our clients in the market, we are figuring out that somehow everybody is looking for how the contactless, how the remote onboarding of client customers can happen. And that's one of the key where we are seeing that a lot of adoption happening in terms of technology or putting together that digital strategy. So that's one piece. The second piece is that obviously when you're not able to meet the customers, when you're not able to go and reach out and customers cannot come to the point of sales, et cetera, a shift in the overall strategy in terms of the sales has been that everybody is going for direct to consumer business. So in fact, rather than consumer coming to the financial services institutions, in fact, financial services are trying to reach out to the consumers. And that is where the next shift, which is happening. And this is also leading to, because you're not able to meet up the customers, you're not having any physical interaction. So obviously this is leading to, can we really acquire the customers in a paperless journey? And that's the second shift which we are looking at. I mean, at least we are experiencing in the market. The third and the last thing is that, how do you know about your customer and get to know about their preferences, their lifestyle, about their entire credit appetite, about their risk appetite, et cetera, et cetera. So that is something which is another thing where we are seeing that the organizations are really looking for the data. While most of the financial services have started using the bureau data, but I think alternate data is one place where everybody is trying to get more and more insight. And that is either you go and pick up those data from the digital sources, which is available, or probably you partner with those companies or those partners where they are having the digital data. So in my view, these are the three things which is clearly a change. And there is definitely a shift towards this entire strategy of everybody that rather than technology adoption, I think going more digital and getting more insight about the customer are the key things which is changing in my view.
No, absolutely. I think we are seeing the same pattern across board. I mean, maybe when you said that direct to customer is started, I think there are two things which are happening. Direct to customers is the brilliant piece. And then of course, partnership is also happening where on one side there will be embedded finance player or a fintech and partnering with the NBFC and large player and still doing the onboarding journey, video PD and all of that. So I think the same question again to Ajay, because you see more on the market across board and how do you see digital lending itself and the future ahead?
See, what has happened, you know, if I compare wave one versus wave two and how it's changed the dynamics. In a wave one, we as an industry, were in a shock, to be very honest. And our response time was relatively delayed. That has also impacted our process of reimagining of customers onboarding has also got delayed. But two positive things which has happened that everyone from the customer to financier to the lender to the banks, everyone has pushed to the corner for the digital adoption. And that is one thing which has really helped everyone across the industry, that even customer is pushed towards the digital adoption. And it has pushed in turn to the lending companies to adopt that and to reimagine the process. But we are still in the half-baked situation. By the time we were all looking at, you know, something is going to come, the second wave hit. I think that time the industry has responded in a real, real measured way. By that time, there were many options which people have explored. Some digital adoption would have already happened in many organizations. Some organization would have been in an advanced stage. But one clear advantage of this pandemic is given that everyone customer and a lender and even marketplace has changed their customer onboarding process. Now, they don't believe that only physical interaction or interacting with customer in person is the only way of onboarding. And that's where the change in the marketplace are going to happen. And I think everyone is saying the crisis should not go waste. I think that is a one point which has came into play for all of us.
No, I agree. I think so what we are also realizing in the market is that everybody, and including PSUs and old world guys, everybody is moving on. In fact, today we were like in another place where we were with a PSU bank, and the way they were looking at digital, I just can't imagine how the thought process is changing, how the structures are built. Imagine that there's a fintech head for a PSU bank and looking for engagement. There are analytics head. Everything is getting built. I think the people are changing in the mindset side, right? But let's move. This was a broader question. Let's come back to real activity on the ground. We heard a lot. I mean, we were earlier, I think 3 years back, the eKYC was the prime move. And in 2018, somewhere, I think Aadhaar suddenly became a challenge and it was taken away. I mean, we had this something candy in our hand and the candy was taken away. Everybody became digital. And mm-hmm. It a lot of ruckus. Now, that has been replaced largely with a video KYC. So I wanted to first get a feedback from you, Pratyush. How does it work? What is it that, I mean, we also hear a lot of challenges with it. Where it is operational, what can we do with it? So it will be good for us to get a view, one from someone who has seen the market and also deploying those platforms. How does it work? And then, of course, we'll get a real practical as a user perspective. So over to you, Pratyush, and guide us on that.
Sure. I think one is that contactless doing the KYC verification without meeting the customer face to face. I think that's one of the things which has always been there. And if you look at overall, there are, in my view, there are six types of KYC which you can do. And as a financial organization, you have one of the most acceptable norm is that you meet up the customer, you take the physical paper, do original sign and verified and do this. So that's the normal process which has been there before pandemic came, hit the market. Subsequently, obviously, there was a eKYC. So eKYC was acceptable by the banks only. I think NBFC and FinTech can't do this. But if you refer to the PMLA guidelines, and there are four ways of doing this KYC in a different form, which does not require the customer face-to-face interaction. One is digital KYC. Second one is a central KYC. Offline KYC, which is again an Aadhaar-based paperless KYC. And the video KYC. The adoption of video KYC was not enough in the market if you look at about 1 year back. But today, with the recent changes in terms of regulations, which RBI has actually came up with a new circular on 10th of May, the scope and the usage of this video KYC has been increased. So in my view, I think that's one of the very big steps in terms of moving towards the digital adoption. And I think this is clearly indicating that even the regulators are promoting and providing that environment where you can go more and more digital. So the way it has to be looked at is that video KYC has got some processes to be put in place, some controls which you have to adopt, and who can use it, right? So there are three things one has to look at if any financial services wants to use this video KYC. One, what is the process you need to follow? So there is a journey which you need to follow. The second, there are some controls, and the controls are like you have to have a customer on the video, you have to have a PAN verification, you have to have a geotagging done, and then so and so on. So there are some 3-4 checks there. So in my view, the adoption has been very, very slow. But in the recent past, I think we are clearly seeing that many of the banks and NBFC are moving towards this. And with the recent changes in the circular, I think this is going to be fastly adopted. This is going to be adopted across various businesses because the changes are there. And I think I would like to also talk about the changes which has happened maybe probably sometimes later, where we can clearly see that how currently being used by, and maybe Ajay can talk about this, how from a lender side, he is viewing this entire thing, because from a service provider side, obviously, this is what we are looking at this point of time.
Thank you, Pratyush. Thank you, Pratyush. I was looking at the data of a bank, a large small finance bank. And I mean, large means you can figure out which large one. they had data for everything, right? But the number of video KYC based account opening was very limited. It was in thousands instead of lakhs, because everything was in lakhs and crores, right? So I wanted to know, how is video KYC getting sort of perceived by the market, Ajay, your users? How are they able to optimize it? And do you believe that that journey will continue to upgrade and you'll continue to gain more traction on that?
I think as a tool, as a video KYC, I think it's an shot in the arm, because it has given you a lot of ability to reach out to the customer without getting affected with the pandemic situations. This has a one of your important part of your customer onboarding journey. Obviously, all companies, all NBFC have their some sort of tool on which they do the onboarding. If at the right, in whatever place as per the organizational aspect, they put the video KYC in between. I think that is playing a big role. And it is not disrupting your customer onboarding position. Even if there is a place of lockdown or there are risk movement restrictions, I think this gives you a lot of flexibility to continue your business operations. Because even in the pandemic, there are people who are requiring some loan assistance, some cash assistance, some kind of an ability to borrow money. But this would have been the best tool at first wave if it would have been available. Obviously, RBI has also acted smartly and given the legal status to this. It is absolutely a very good tool in terms of to continue your business customer onboarding without any hindrances of outside situations, and which falls into the legal compliance of all RBI regulations. So it has really added value. It has actually given us edge over the rest of the activities which we can.
So from your perspective,
or anyone who is doing so.
Great. So from your perspective, customers are really engaging with them. They are not looking at it as a deterrent and running away. They are actually able to use it as well, right?
See, any digital intervention from a customer side will take some amount of time, to be very honest. But it's cumbersome. His customer is very uncomfortable to do so. My experience and the feedback is not like that. Customer are willing, because customer also now very, very careful. They don't want it to meet you, whichever form they want. They wanted to avoid that physical interaction. And the customer digital adoption is also a very fast moving activity now. But never say the people, some portion of people may be uncomfortable to do so. But over a period of time, and I think in a max 2 to 3 months time, the people's acceptance ratio has increased. I don't see a challenge which is there on a very, very practical terms. Yes, a few people may have that, but I don't see on a larger one, people are more adaptive and welcoming this tool to reach out to them for a KYC purpose.
Okay. I think at this point in time, it will be good for us to have a quick view on how exactly does it look like. Because kabhi kabhi hota hai, dekha nahi hota, toh ajeeb lagta hai, aur humare partner ne dekha ho, toh humne dekha nahi, right? So that's just, maybe it will be good if you can have a quick, 2 minutes view on what exactly are we talking about.
Sure, Samir, let me take this and I'll talk about it, and then I have a small demo as well, which I can actually put in. Give me a minute.
Yeah, and in the meantime, I've seen questions coming in. You can, if you are not okay to send to everyone, you can send it to me one-on-one. But let's keep getting the questions and we'll try to answer as much as we can. And then I know that we are all humans. Some we can't, and we'll come back on that. So keep engaging. And there are also from the deck perspective, some of them you will come back saying we need a deck. So as you give feedback back to us, as we move towards the end, we'll share you the link for feedback. There, when you give a feedback, we'll share you back our deck and anything else which you're looking at. So over to you, Patish.
Sure. Thank you. So as I mentioned earlier, so if you look at the video KYC, the way I was saying is that there is a process, then there is a control, and who can use this video KYC process, right? This is as per the, I'm talking about the original form when the video KYC was launched. So if you look at the process, you need to have a live video, you need to do the offline KYC, you need to collect the PAN and then verify it with the NSDL, which is the issuing authority. And then obviously, as per internal risk policy, every organization has got their official valid document which needs to be collected as part of the KYC. So what you need to do, this is a process which has been defined as per the PMLA guideline. Now, what are the controls which that guidelines talks about? The controls are, whenever you are doing this video recording, you need to tag the geo. So geolocation has to be captured. You need to have a photo match, the face match from the video versus whatever identity document you are collecting. You need to have a random question. So you need you may put a two or three different questions while talking to the customers. You need to have a liveness check so that you ensure that the customer is there and there is absolutely no video or nothing which is being done. And then whatever offline KYC you are doing, either on the go, on the journey, or if the customer has already done earlier, that has to be not more than 3 days old. So that's the control which clearly regulators are advising. Now, who can do this? The entities who can do this is our banks. Banks can do this. NBFC can do this. Fintechs can do this. Fintechs who are actually having their own balance sheet, they can do this. That's the video KYC process, which is originally launched. Now, what has changed? Let us look at what has changed. So the recent circular, which has come up in the month of May, that talks about various changes. And when we tried to put it as a category and clearly identifying that where all, what all changes have been done, this is the summary. Now, what has changed? There has been change in the scope. There has been change in advice on in terms of the video KYC infrastructure, video KYC process, and then the record management. Now, let's go quickly one by one, and then probably I'll walk you through with a demo as well. Now, in terms of scope, the usage of this video KYC has been expanded to the newer customer segment. Now you can go and do the small businesses, you can do the for the authorized signatories, you can do for the owner of a legal entities, and you can go and you can complete even when you are doing the re-KYC. So you can use the video KYC as one of the method to really complete this process. So that's the scope change. So basically you are going and you are giving regulators talking about, give the extension to this that the more and more organizations can use. The second thing, they have advised that, okay, these are the scope extension. However, you need to put some controls in overall infrastructure. What are those changes? You need to do this from the secured network. So registered entity has to do this with the secured network. There has to be encryption of data when you are actually initiating this, or the customer is on the other side. You need to ensure that this entire data gets encrypted. Earlier, there was a requirement that you are doing the geotagging, because if the customer is not in India, that is not going to be valid. However, with the recent changes, regulator also advised, you need to make sure that there is no IP spoofing. So people are not really using the VPN, somebody sitting in different country really demonstrating that they are in India and doing. So how do you ensure that we are increasing the scope, but let's also ensure that you are ensuring that there is no IP spoofing. Whatever recording, video recording you are doing, that has to be time and date stamped. So they regulator is clearly saying that everything needs to have an audit trail with a time and date stamp. So that's the another thing. Now, scope is for the financial services to increase. Infrastructure is something where service provider has to build. So people like us who are providing the video KYC, or probably if the banks and NBFCs are doing them themselves, then there is a process guideline. So what are the process changes with one when you are doing this video KYC? What are the process changes? So basically, any time during this video KYC, if the video gets interrupted, services gets interrupted, you have to start the session from fresh. So basically, this is in continuation, the entire video KYC process has to happen. So if a registered entity and the customer is doing this video KYC process, and somewhere the video gets disconnected, call gets disconnected, so you can't be continuing from there, you'll have to again start from fresh. That's as a process guideline. Now, identifying that what are the e-documents which is available. If there are e-documents available through the mode of DigiLocker, you have to go and pick up those e-documents from the DigiLocker. That's an extension which has been given. And then there are banking correspondents can also conduct on behalf of their banks this video KYC process. So these are some of the high level changes. While there are many changes, there are more than almost 30, 35 changes if you go one by one that what are the changes which has happened. But largely, this is something which I've tried to capture. In terms of record management, again, regulators are advising that it has to be kept in a storage where it has to be clearly identified on a future date. So you need to have a date, timestamp clearly so that in future date, if you want to refer, you can easily refer. This has to be an encrypted mode. It has to be preserved for any kind of audit in the future by the regulators, because obviously this is one of the things where you're expanding the scope of this. So I think these are some of the changes which has been advised. And then if you are looking at these things, then video KYC is actually coming in a completely revised form where you are doing a lot of other checks also. So this is exactly the way the video KYC works. Let me just take a couple of minutes to run you through the process, and I have a small demo which may probably give you the entire process understanding.
And Pratish, I will also come back
in the end. Elon is
Pratish, I'll also maybe in this session I will showcase what offer you are giving to the participant, right? And that's also important that people know about what offer they are you are making as part of this session as well. So we'll build that. Go ahead.
Sure. Dynamic and hardworking professional who leads customer onboarding at his organization. Business demands him to onboard genuine customers quickly and efficiently, but his biggest nightmare is identity fraud, which could lead to a company's financial and reputational loss. Elon often worries if the KYC procedures at his company fit into the norms of the changing world. Conventional KYC procedures involve physical customer verifications, which are costly, time-consuming, and error-prone, and involve physical contact, something which is a no-no post-COVID-19 outbreak. Presenting Authbridge's video KYC solution, a contactless verification and remote onboarding platform, an AI-powered and real-time authentication technology which is compliant, cost-effective, and convenient. With seamless customer authentication and onboarding, banking-grade assisted and non-assisted video KYC, almost 10 times increase in application processing, easily integratable APIs and end-to-end onboarding workflows. That is not all. With a range of technical capabilities, like OCR-based national ID details extraction and validation, Aadhaar KYC, liveness check, geolocation capture, face match between selfie and national ID photo, end-to-end encrypted video upload on RE server. So now Elon can stop worrying about the cost and regulatory pressures of verifying customers with a face-to-face executive connect. Elon gets a completely automated, paperless, secure and real-time video-based KYC and re-KYC. With one decision, Elon made himself and his company happy and more secure. You could too. Call us to know how we can help you achieve up to 50% reduction in onboarding costs, up to 90% reduction in onboarding time, up to 90% mitigation in financial and identity risks, and up to 100% increase in process efficiency. Reach out and explore the best contactless verification and onboarding platform for your business.
So I hope this was clear in terms of overall process and whatever controls we are talking about, that as a part of journey we have tried to demonstrate here. Obviously, some regulations have come up, so those are the things which is already incorporated and which is there.
Thank you. Thank you, Pratish. And maybe because I think the point I was saying is that you can take the screen off. I think the one question which people were you were talking about the offer. I think I thought it may be useful if you could sort of share this what the offer is. So maybe all those who will sort of submit your forms and details, I think they will get a feedback from the Authbridge team. Maybe you want to quickly please talk about what they will get immediately from your side.
Yeah, sure. I mean, what we are doing is that basically we are providing some of the offers. So one is that free trial, and then there is an early bird. So early bird offer is basically we are referring to where we are giving some period or some numbers as a free as a part of the contract. And free trial is basically available as a sandbox. So anybody is interested, complete the form, give us the detail. And then there are some more information which would be required, because obviously these are some of the regulated process. So obviously white labeling plus concurrence, consent, etc. is required. And you can reach out to us and we will ensure that you get this these offers and start using it.
Thank you. So I think the feedback form will be opening in maybe a few minutes and we'll do that. Maybe Sonali is somebody you can actually start sharing the feedback so that people can actually start filling it up. But let's continue with our agenda as well. Now, I think we thought of video KYC as one activity, right? Video is just not the start and the end. There are other things possible as well, right? So I want to know, maybe, and this time I'll go to Ajay from your side. Now, video is video, right? What more is possible? We started hearing about video PD as well. And what more is possible? So maybe if you can define what exactly is video PD and how are you using in real world? And maybe what other use cases you can think of? So over to you, Ajay. And also learn a lot from that perspective. Over to you.
This tool, which we are actually tried out in our organization, particularly for the cases for where you required some credit intervention by actually interacting with customer. Obviously, in a current situation, reaching out to the customer in person is not advisable. And we tried this. I think it's an effective tool. It's a quite interactive. As your customer sitting in front of you, that kind of situation comes. This is but experience from a credit viewpoint. What my feedback, which I have received from my credit team, is that they could able to compare this video PD with the PD which they have done in person. Has been no less than what the physical PD is. Few examples people try, we wanted to see the stock in your shop, what is that, which factory you're doing, which how many machines you have, that kind of. I think this flexibility is also plays a very important role, because you are actually inside the shop with the customer or in the shop with in his factory. It's giving you a lot of insights and the comfort which credit underwriters needs to buy out of this interaction can also get determined, because by that time he would have analyzes, did his financial assessment, etc. All other information would have been gathered, and to reaffirm and reassertain the whole requirement of his activity would definitely help him in particularly in this time. And it is now should be the norm, a new normal for this kind of, because it doesn't make a sense to travel 2 hours in a place like Bombay to do for on a personal verification or for personal discussion with the customer. So it really helps. I know the adoption even from the organization viewpoints also, and many people adoption within the organization and adoption by the customer is also a little challenge which we'll face. But as I said, that there is a push, and it is the push is not from someone else, but it is a situation has pushed everyone to reimagine the whole onboarding process of the customer, which will be a pandemic proof kind of, or less disruption we will see. So in that case, I think it's a very good tool to imbibe in your customer onboarding journey, customer underwriting journey.
And one quick question. One side is that we bring tool, right? Digital side se tech tech se koi bhi tool la sakta, right? Lekin agar credit bolega ki nahi karna, I don't want to use it. You can't do a shit about it, right? So what has been the usage pattern? I mean, do you see this is saying yaar nahi karna, mujhe to physically karna hai, tum samajhta nahi hai, tum log samajhta nahi hai. So any thoughts on it? How is the adoption? Do you think people are liking it?
I agree, and that's the reason in earlier also I said that adoption within the organization and adoption by the customer is a challenge. But situation is such that whether he likes it or not like it, if I need to do a PD in a place where there is a lockdown, I have no other option. And when you pushed and you practiced it, I think then you come to know the nuances, advantages. There could be a few disadvantages, I'm not denying that. But over a period of time, the adoption becomes a new habit, and customer also then push to that direction. Because we will call a customer saying that if you need a loan, I need to do video PD, please accept. I am sending you the link. Please log into that link and I'm talking to you. So both sides, customer and within the organization, the adoption will some amount of time, but no need of head of the organization or credit head or risk head or IT head need to push them. The situation itself is pushing everyone to think, to reimagine to rewrite the whole onboarding story, which few years back we thought it is written or carved in stone, which is not the reality. If you are not changing and looking at a futuristic way and adaption is less, no, we will either you will have to change or you will get changed. This is as simple as this.
No, I agree. I think बहुत साल पहले I mean होता था, you used to have this VC, right? Video conference. And it always was a difficult device, very expensive device. उसको चलाने में जान निकल जाती थी. And now we all are on Zoom. Everybody on Zoom and nobody cares, right? And it नहीं चल रहा. It works, right? So I think that's a world, right? We are completely changing. And maybe we'll not just move to maybe KYC or maybe PPD. We'll go to all scenarios, right? Video something. So the way you have mobility, the way you have this, maybe video something is happening. But any which way, I think it will be good for us to understand from offering perspective, what exactly are we offering on the video PD side? Any quick 1 or 2 minutes we want to share, Pratyush, anything? And both to Ajay and Pratyush, ये कठिन क्वेश्चन जो लोग पूछ रहे हैं, मैं नहीं जवाब देने वाला. ये सब आपके लिए है. मैं वो हूँ, क्या कहते हैं, ये नॉर्मली मेरे ऊपर आता है, मैं जवाब देता हूँ, बट दिस टाइम आपके ऊपर. So it's all on you. Be ready, okay? I'm bringing them back to you, and that's why I did not take it only on me. It's publicly available, so I'm here on purpose. And all those who are asking your questions, we will be differently asking those questions as well. So Pratyush, aap batao, video PD mein what exactly is the norm and how are we able to use it?
So video PD is basically it's a replacement of what exactly you are doing in a interaction between the underwriter and the MSME, or say in the housing finance. I think largely, whatever interactions are happening, and that is where we also realize that there is a bottleneck. And once you are doing and going ahead with the video KYC, probably for some segments you need to have a video PD also, considering there are a lot of challenges in terms of physical interaction, bringing together multiple set of people. So let me again just put one slide on video PD so that I can actually explain it much better. So, I hope my slide is visible. So basically, the journey, in the video PD is basically there are two or three things which is a key where we are also providing this solution in terms of you are connecting to your prospective MSME or say your mortgage customers where you are connecting through the video calls. You have an option of doing identity verification on the fly. You have an option of verifying the address from where the customer is staying. You can also do the liveness check, again preventing those fraud aspects. So basically a link gets generated and it goes to your customer. What you are doing is that basically on the video recording, you are asking the questions which is related to probably the underwriting, maybe some of the business understanding of them, or you may probably also want to take some of the picture of their offices, etc. So that is something which is possible. The unique thing is that this is something where you can actually do as much as say 6 to 8 people at same point of time. So a lot of times what happens that directors, promoters, or probably the owner, business owners does not have the full financial detail. They would like to connect with the finance guy, probably their chartered accountants, or maybe involve some of the people who are working for them. There are some partners, some different offices, different places directors are sitting. So that's the reason this entire thing has been built, considering that you can connect 6 to 8 people together and have those conversation, providing an option of doing the real-time address verification, doing the real-time identity verification also, where you are not, restricting them to doing the fraud. So basically liveness check, etc. And then at the same time, if some documents are required on the fly, you can actually providing this facility of uploading those documents also. So look at, something where you are going to the customer and then from there on, you figure it out, something is there with the other partner or say their chartered accountant, you're bringing everybody together. And this process efficiency is something which is very, very unique. And if you look at it from the cost benefit analysis, obviously this is much, much more cheaper than what you would be spending if you're really going and doing this physical verification. So I think this is very, very important tool. And we are very clearly seeing that in SME space and in the mortgage space, a lot of inquiries are coming, a lot of requirements are coming. And this is not only in terms of doing this at the time of onboarding. I think subsequently also when you want to do and review the limits or do after a year, some kind of an enhancement in the limit, etc. I think these technology and these tools are going to be inevitable, considering that there's a lot of push on digital. And in my view, this is the great platform, because you are anyway doing video KYC, which is a push from the regulators. And why don't you adopt this as well, which can actually give you further access to do your underwriting process in a much seamless manner.
No, this is excellent. This is excellent. So I think while we are at it, maybe one more sequential question, and maybe from an opportunity perspective, Ajay, you want to share later on, you can talk about it. But KYC rules are changing, right? Today we can do a KYC for video KYC can be used also for a current account, basically non-individuals as well, right? Now non-individuals, you can do anything, right? Which can be, you can do it for proprietorship. There's also a framework for others as well, which is authorized signatories as well, and beneficiary owners as well. And on the other side, there's also a framework for re-KYC, which is not very pertinent for maybe lending, but actually more relevant for current accounts and other sites, right? So maybe you could guide us, because a lot of people would not know what's happening on the KYC changes. So quickly, maybe you want to guide us, what is the change and how it can help?
See, in terms of changes in the KYC norms, RBI is quite given us a lot of flexibility to operate. And it's at the starting point, what you have mentioned, that digital previously when it was an vendor-based KYC was happening, towards now the tool has already been given to us. But it depends on organizational approach towards the customer onboarding experience. We are still following the physical KYC, taking the pen and paper, xeroxing it, saying original as seen. But as an NBFC or any bank, what is your goal towards customer onboarding journey, and how you wanted to facilitate it, and how you wanted to rate your customer experience of onboarding? If there are tools are available which can really cut your time, which will be relatively pandemic proof, and gives you a same amount of a compliance or more compliant than your earlier one, I think there is no harm. You should keep that agility on. And I was seeing some question that this is the only way. I think you should have 1, 2, 3, 4 options open. And it is not, and as I said, that one may work in one state, one may not even work in another state or another customer segment, if I may say so. But having those options open and offering the customer experience of an hassle-free, a touch-free kind of situation in current situation can give everybody an advantage. And we play within that RBI regulations. The RBI given us an options. There are many KYC options around. So I think it would be a organizational approach towards the customer onboarding process, and how that seriousness we have towards changing that environment, adapting digital environment more, and you know, making that customer journey seamless for the organization and fantastic for the customer will provide you that right solution. And it is not fit for all every solution, because each customer segment, customer, each NBFC, each bank has a different customer profile to deal with.
No, this is good.
So only going for this or that direction would not be my suggestion. I think the agility comes very, very clear. And your adoption towards customer onboarding journey is going to be your key area to adopt all the solutions which are available on the earth.
Okay, so at this point in time, I think maybe from a just question, because I think a lot of people are asking that how do they get the deck which you are presenting, and also how do they participate in getting that free offer? I think the point again is the free offer is available as long as you fill the form, so we can reach out to you, because we don't know, out of some 300 odd people who are registered, we don't even know how many of them would be interested in that. So it will be difficult. So it will be good if you can fill the form. Form is made right available right here on the chat box. So please go ahead and fill the form, and we'll continue to sort of take the session. Maybe Pratish, from your perspective, quick, maybe a few minutes on the new regulations, and because we want to actually move towards Q&A as well, right? So maybe maybe as part of it, you can also do a potentially a quick demo also of the address verification, because which we have seen a lot of criticality of it because people say कहाँ रहता है पता नहीं है वही चीज रह गई okay मैं बोला यार ये कर लेते हैं so we want to talk about the address verification as well once you do this discussion.
Yeah, sure. I mean, so digital address verification is one of the, I mean, if you look at even today, whatever sourcing is happening, almost 30% of those sourcing is going for a physical verification, where the customer is staying, et cetera, et cetera. And I think with the digital adoption and with most of the companies looking for this, how do we do things digitally? Another change and shift which is coming up is there a way to do this in a smarter way without meeting the customer? And if you look at the core of this entire digital, I would say, adoption, one of the things which is very, very important here is that you are actually moving towards where you are making sure that the customer is doing the journey themselves rather than having an assisted way. So basically, you are allowing customer to declare the information and then ask them to complete some of the process, which will actually help you to do whether it is a KYC, whether it is video PD, whether it is a digital address verification. So one of the platform where we are seeing a lot of traction is that digital address verification, where this platform initiate a link to the customer for which you want to really verify the address. And there are some one and a half minute journey where there are some 3 or 4 steps through which you are able to ensure that the customer is staying at that particular address. And this is one that you can do this at the time of onboarding. Subsequently, once you have disbursed the loan, you can subsequently also do it to figure it out whether the customer is staying there or not. So what happens is that you initiate the link, then there is a confirmation which happens, authentication of your mobile number, then your address are being taken, your selfie is being taken, your address GPS is getting tagged, and the triangulation of this entire information gives the final output. Okay, the customer has done this journey themselves. That's number one. Customer confirms that he's staying at this address. And as per this process, when he was doing the process, this was his geotagging. But when he has also given you the address proof, you are also knowing that what is the actual address and the geotagging accordingly. And then you do the triangulation and figure it out whether the customer is staying at the same address or not. One of the advantage of this is one and a half minute of process. You can do multiple times or say multiple frequency, and you can still ensure that the customer is there. So broadly on this slide, I've put in the process, but it would be good to understand from the video which we have right now. So let me just put the video.
Hello there. If you like the idea of digitally verifying addresses of your customers, here's a cherry on top. Your staff member can easily manage this entire process from anywhere, anytime. Check it for yourself. The entire case initiation and review process will be over before you finish your coffee. You log into our portal to access the Footprints Digital, our digital address verification product. You may either choose to initiate cases or review case summaries. To initiate cases, you get 2 options to choose from, single case or many at once. Enter basic details and address of your customer one at a time and initiate individual cases. Or choose to upload an Excel file with details of several customers and initiate cases in bulk. The template for this bulk upload can be downloaded from right here. Once you initiate the cases, your customers get notified via email and SMS with a unique link. Using their smartphone, they can easily verify their address within 5 minutes. They need to register with their mobile number, enter basic details, and upload selfie picture, identity document, and house pictures. The rest is taken care of by us. The selfie image and identity document allow customer authentication based on a face match score, while house pictures and GPS coordinate triangulation ensures accurate verification of address stated by the customer. That's half the job done. How's the coffee going? Now to review the cases you have already raised, just go to case summary. Here you will see all the cases listed with latest ones on the top. You can search by name, mobile number, or filter based on case status. Find the case you are looking for and click here to view summary of case details, geo coordinates, and face match score. You can even view the pictures uploaded by the customer, like selfie, house pics, and the national ID. And one last thing. It's flexible enough to be aligned to your footprints and adapt to your applicant tracking systems via APIs. I hope you enjoyed this video, just like your coffee. Thanks for your time. Bye.
what is happening is that you are able to complete a journey, which is a seamless journey. On the fly, you can actually complete this seamless journey where there is no manual intervention, and you are able to verify the address also. And this is one of the great platform where you can use this for a multiple things: address verification, post disbursement asset verification, probably for the early warning signal. There is a one company who is thinking that if we have a larger some limit threshold beyond some transactions, can I send this link and really figure it out that this transaction has happened at X place, the customer is also at the same place. So multiple use cases, and we can clearly see that there's an advantage of doing this digitally, and it's all the data which is you are getting captured, and you are subsequently using this, because over a period of time the analytics on top of it will also give you some of the hidden patterns that how the customers are behaving once this type of customer is doing this process.
Excellent. So I think there's a connected question which I've just seen from Mohit Taparia. Mohit, do you want to ask your question, please?
Yeah, sure, Sumi. Thanks for that. So I was just trying to understand.
If you could just tell from where you are, so that, or maybe you could put your view on, that'll be easier.
Sure, Sumi. So yeah, so I'm actually working as a senior business analyst for one of the Indian retail banks. And traditionally, how we do the verifications, which is actually a pain, is it's done manually by, you know, the fleet on street, or the bank ties up with a third party. But right now, as I understand, the need of the hour is actually to get that digitalized, which I just saw at, you know, the flow. What I was trying to understand is manually, if it is done, it takes typically days, right? To 2 days initially, and even, you know, more than that. But if we do it digitally, how, what is the TAT, and, you know, how, I mean, what is the accuracy as well, you know, so that to, you know, it is, I mean, you would have done some level of regression as well there to try and understand that, you know, it's working or if it's not. I mean, I was just trying to understand that. So I'm in the retail banking, specifically unsecured lending space, where I work right now.
Sure.
Sorry for the long question.
Yeah. Very good question and very interesting question. And that's where we are bringing also the best of the best practices. So there is obviously a statistics, and once you fill up the feedback form, you'll get those statistics also around this. So in our case, wherever we are doing, 86% of the cases so far has been successful using this platform. So basically what we are saying is that 86% of the cases, you are able to complete the process fully, where you are able to take the decision. 14% of the cases, we have not been able to process fully because of multiple reasons, whether it's a customer-related issue where customer has not completed the journey, or maybe customer has filled in some of the information which is not accepted, because this journey also have some of the interventions of seeing if the ID proof has to be there, then it has to be an ID proof. It cannot be something else, something like that. So that's one of the statistics. The second is that out of whatever we have completed, almost 76% of the cases gets completed within 15 minutes. So if you're sending a link on a particular time within 15 minutes, the moment customer starts, the 15 minutes, this entire process gets completed, and you get to know whether this is address is confirmed or not. And it is not only about the address, it is also about three things. Pratyush says, say in case I am doing. So this is the Pratyush who has done this journey himself. Second, he has been on this declared address. So he has completed this address. Third, as per his address, the geotagging was X. And when he's doing this journey, his geotagging is X. While there are some variations in the geotagging, which is there, and that is also, again, state to state different geotagging. Somewhere it is a 70 meter difference, somewhere 100 meter distance. I think those are also one of the learnings which we have got. And whenever we work with any of the financial institutions, we provide those best practices, because ultimately you have to decide what is the difference you want to take. So largely 86%, I mean 80 to 85% problem is getting solved in less than 15 minutes.
Perfect. Thank you so much for your answer, sir. Appreciate that.
Thank you.
I think I know I'm slightly going random, but I think it's a sort of, also we have Shashi here. Shashi there, Tamuladi. Shashi, you want to ask your question, please?
Hey, sorry, I was just typing. Thank you.
No, I just saw that you are typing. I said, let me just cut down your work and then get you out of it. And it's not easy to see Shashi there, Tamuladi, so I'll also get a chance to see. And please don't, I'm not ignoring anyone, but I just typed, I thought, got him.
No, sorry. Thanks for your kindness. So my question, Pratyush, is that, see, microfinance is, again, growing in a large industry and it's digitizing fast as well. But we still wonder what is the right option to adopt for the alternate KYCs that can be used among all the options that you mentioned. Because practically, these customers are not necessarily owning phones, not necessarily in good connectivity zones, and they're rural women, not digitally educated, and all that stuff.
Yeah. So again, great question, Shashi. And I'm glad that you asked this question because Ajay is also on the call. And we have been working on one of the pilot where Ajay is also similarly tier four, where there is absolutely the customers are not very digital savvy and they are using those feature phone, etc. So in the digital address verification or say digital KYC, both are having the same platform. Now, one journey is that where customer is doing the self-serve journey, where largely say even 50% of your population or a customer can do this. So that is solved. The rest 50% of the population, we can provide the assisted model where you have your authorized agents. And actually this link is going on their mobile and they are completing these processes when they are meeting with the customer. Now, how do you ensure that the customer has done it? There are multiple ways. You can do through their Aadhaar-based authentication. So you can generate OTP on the fly. You can punch in, or maybe you can take the gesture-based signature. So I think two ways you can solve this. One, wherever the customer is digital savvy, they can do the journey themselves. Or if they are not, then probably it is an agent-based where there are some different controls which is put in. But we have done some pilot, small pilot, and we realize that the success is there. So it is getting actually done appropriately with the all kind of, fraud prevention, or probably making sure that your agent is going to that particular address, because then we, instead of two geotagging, we do probably three geotagging. And that agent is there, customer is there, actual as per address, this is a geotagging. So assisted model will work in your environment, what I understand.
Thank you. We are building, workflows to make it even presence-less, self-initiated options. So you think there is, it's a bit of a time before we get there for these customers?
Not really. I think it is, you can easily do this, whenever you want, and you can try and adopt this. But I think initially it will take some time to kind of really, because you have to change the overall process, your journeys are defined. I think it may take a bit of time, but as far as adoption is concerned, I think you can easily start with a pilot and then see how fast that's getting benefited to everybody, including the customer and your agent and the team.
Great. Thank you so much, Pratyush.
Thanks,
Amir.
Thank you. I think the next question is from Kaushik. Rajendra Bisht, I'll come back to you in a minute. The question is from Kaushik. Would you want to ask a question, please?
Yeah. Hi. Am I audible?
Yes.
I can't come on the video because I'm using the laptop. It's closed. I have multiple monitors working over here.
No.
So anyway, it's actually the same thing that I wanted to ask. As earlier it was mentioned, like a date and timestamp will be used. My only concern over there was when the date and timestamp are being used, will that happen on the customer side, or will that happen on the financial entity side, so who's using the solution? And if it is the first option, then I was suggesting if a unique hash generator can be used instead to provide a key identifier that okay, this has been recorded at Greenwich Mean Time this, and so on and so forth. So that was the first question. I have a second question, but I'll wait after you answer this.
So this is recorded at financial institution side, and actually this is getting tagged and printed at the same time on the videos. So that is completely on the financial institution. It is not about the customer side, because the application itself tagged this with the IP and the timestamp and the date stamp. And this happens completely through the journey. And then obviously once you get the final output also, this is also stamped that way. And it is stamped based on the identifier, the name and ID, identity documents, whatever has been captured. Everything gets stamped and time and date stamped with that. So even at the end of this, you generate a PDF report, which is more of a record for the record purposes. Obviously, when the Video KYC links get generated. It has two parts. One is a video part. Second is a documentation part. But so that is getting stored in your database. And then you have a PDF, which is actually clearly for the record management. You can keep it in the file, take the printout, et cetera, if required. Otherwise, it's a part of the file. So there it is completely. Everything is time and date stamp based on the application system, not the customer side. So I hope this answers your first question.
Yeah, perfect. The second one, actually, I have a second question. This will be a shorter one, actually. So I want to.
So, Kaushik, can I do it one favor? If my team can give a connection between you and Outbridge team, because I'm just being honest that we are almost at the time gap. We'll continue for maybe 5 to 10 more minutes, but I thought it may be we'll take it directly. Kaushik, is that okay? My team will connect.
Yeah, that's perfectly fine.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. We'll take a few more minutes, questions, if Ajay and Pratyush, you are okay with that?
Yeah, you're okay.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. So, and again, for all of you, there is a free offer of you to use the platform itself. As long as you are meeting the regulatory requirements, you will get offers as well for usage right away. So you please register for that event. Give us feedback. We keep doing it all the time. So it'll be good to get your feedback as well. But the next question is from Viren Rami. Viren, you want to ask your question, please? And it's all very practical questions. So Viren, go ahead, please.
Yeah, thank you for giving the opportunity. The basic question is that I just wanted
Maybe you can introduce yourself because the context will be clear. Then maybe Ajay can also respond because it's important we know the background.
Yeah, sure. See, I myself, Viren Rami. I'm a head of operations for Fortune Integrated Asset Finance Company. It's an basically ITI group company based out at Bombay. And I'm heading operations for asset finance as well as housing finance company, which is called Fast Track Housing Finance. So for this company specifically, I'm looking for a solution related to video KYC and all. So I just have a small query whether this video KYC is mandatory for NBFC or it can be optional. Or if it is not mandatory as of now, and if I wanted, if it is not mandatory as of now, and in future, whether it is useful for me as an NBFC user?
Okay. Ajay, maybe you want to take a short.
No, in terms of there is no mandatory position for video KYC. It's an up to the organization if you wanted to adapt towards that change.
See, I heard that circular, it is only mandatory for banks. For NBFC, it was not mandatory. But my just a question to you, because you guys are senior, very senior in that note, and whether it is useful for me if I adopt this, even though it is not mandatory in nowadays for me?
Pratish, you wanted to take that?
Okay, sure. So first of all, when I said that who can use this, it does not mean that these are the mandatory institutions who have to use this. This is an optional. So as Ajay mentioned that you have a KYC, various KYC facilities available. You can use any one of them depending upon your requirement. Now, in terms of usage, video KYC solves your three purposes, in my view. One, it solves your purpose of regulatory requirement that you are able to complete the KYC of the customer. So that's the first thing. Second is an identity. So you are establishing the identity. That is number one. Number two, when you are doing this video KYC, you're also trying to eliminate at the first end if there are any kind of identity fraud, because the customer himself is there. You are doing the liveness check. You are doing the face match. So the fraud angle, which is there, once you do the KYC also in the normal scenario in the paper-based KYC, and you have subsequently the fraud that, okay, he had put in somebody else's information or probably something else. So I think that's the second aspect. The third aspect is that it is more seamless, faster, and where it reduces your cost. So look at the way cost reduction in terms of your keeping the records, doing this entire process on a 15 minutes of video calls or probably the 10 minutes of video call, completing the entire documentation through the digital way. And then also you are doing in a similar 10 minutes of journey. You are actually verifying these information. So if you are taking the PAN, you are verifying it from the source and you're ensuring that correct PAN. When you are taking the driving license, you are again verifying. Or if you are taking voter ID, you are again verifying. So I think the advantage of this is that this is the future. Clearly, it is giving our regulatory blessings when RBI is coming and saying that no, you can expand the scope. You can do this for multiple types of organization. So in my view, there's a lot of merit in adopting this, because a similar platform you can use further for various other checks as well, which might be useful. And that's the way the entire lending industry is at least moving towards.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for clarifying.
Thanks.
Yeah, I think Rajendra has his hand up for some time. But again, we will give you access to this platform as well as you'll have access to the deck. And your feedback will definitely help us in improving. I think that'll be good. But Rajendra, please go ahead and introduce yourself.
Thanks, Amir. Good evening, everyone. Good evening, Pratyush, Ajay sir. I'm Rajendra Bhishchar.
Ryan, तब तक ही सुनूंगा जब तक मैं तुम्हें देखूंगा नहीं. आप मुझे देख सकते हो, मैं आपको नहीं, ये गलत बात.
No, not an issue. Let me start my video. Am I visible and audible clearly there?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Great. Hi, Samir. Good evening, Pratyush, Ajay sir. I'm Rajendra Bhish from Pune. I head IT and digital initiatives, and I work for a large NBFC attached to a auto manufacturing unit in Pune. My question to Pratyush and Ajay sir both is that though the technology is very good, I mean, I have personally used it, to open a bank account or a Demat account. I really loved it. There's a convenience to it, and it doesn't take any time. I think 100%, I'm sure that it is beneficial for the organization like us also. But somehow it is in the beginning, at the nascent stage, and the message, because it needs an auditor in between, and there's a requirement that you need to have an auditor in between. Basically, you'll have to hire a person. That message is going to go to the people like us, and my management and my users. So how do we solve that problem, Pratyush? Is it right or wrong? Second, sir, to Ajay sir, because you have been at the decision-making side. So how do we ensure that we take the, necessary approvals in such kind of good initiatives, but I think somewhere in the budgetary jungle, we don't get the approvals on this.
Okay. So let me answer the first phase. I think when we are saying that this is an auditor or say agent has to start, and then there are three parties, I think it is more to define the role. And this role is more from a governance perspective, how this video KYC has to be done. So basically what happens, so there is no, first of all, there is absolutely no requirement of a separate set of people or hiring separate set of people. Your underwriter becomes probably the auditor here. But somebody from your organization has to initiate and complete this process. And that can be any of the agent or say any of the person of your organization, or maybe your some of those, if you're from the bank, banking correspondence guys can also do. So that's number one. I don't think you need an additional people. It's just a role which has been defined, like you have a fraud control person, you have a risk underwriter. So similarly, you have a role which is defined. I think this is very easy, but yes, very important question to understand. And I think Ajay should answer, because actually they have adopted it. So probably he'll be able to tell you exactly how it is being adopted.
I think to be on the right side of the law, RBI says that authorized person of an organization needs to validate the KYC. Now it's an organization to decide whom to authorize. And I segment it into 3-4 products. Obviously, where your ticket size are different, you can have your credit guys to manage that, or operation guys to manage that. If you're into a small ticket business, you can authorize a person sitting at the POS can also do that. But it has to be properly documented, and obviously it has to be rightly vetted by the board. So once you do that, then I don't think the adoption becomes a challenge, because currently also, particularly from your business viewpoint, at the POS customer walks in, I take a photocopy, his original SIM verified stamp put, and that guy who is operating signs it because we authorized him. So in this case also, we can authorize him and he is entitled to do so with the authorization. Then you remain on the right side of the law, notification. In terms of the other question which you asked about the budgetary side, I don't think it has that impact, because it will rather will save cost. If you really count the unit which you do or mean the high volume business, the number of photocopies, if you go with the normal way, we take two photocopies, front end and back. If you're smart enough, you're taking two, what the photocopies on a one paper, then yes, we have taken on productivity to the next level, if I may say so. But that's the sheer cost. And when we provide this, so I don't see there is a challenge, but the question which you asked on the right side, yes, if you have to evaluate and put those people on the authorization mode. So then I don't think there is any challenge with this.
Right. Thanks, Ajay sir. Thanks, Pratyush. I think I got my answers.
Okay. Thank you. I think I know we have breached the time, and I also know that my practical aspect that 5 pe, I'm sure sabka kuch na kuch planned hoga. Mera bhi planned hai, aapka bhi planned hai. But this is amazing session. I think mujhe lagta hai ki log bolte tumhe kaise pata rehta hai. Aap jaise logon se saath milta rehta hu, aapke cutting. Rajendra, aapke question question aur aap logon ke jawab se main bhi sikhta rehta hu. So thank you. I think this session has been fabulous, and my thanks to all the participants here. As I said, you please share your feedback. The feedback link is available. Please go ahead and do it. Sometimes actually being hands-on is always useful, right? Sometimes PPT mein dekh dekh ke aadmi ko samajhta nahi karna kya, right? You get actually experience. So please use that. And I think we were looking at two sides. One for more from somebody who provides a platform. I think Ajay, thank you for sharing your insights in depth. And you have worked on the other side as well, so you know what it is. And Ajay, I think your practical or the on the ground aspects are always useful. Otherwise, kya wo hawa mein laga rahega aur jab ground mein baithega to kuch use nahi ho payega. I think this is also sort of damn powerful. And I'm so surprised that right now we have breached the time, and I don't know how many people are still there. I think 58 people are still there. So this, I think thank you. I think thanks Ajay and Pratyush. Your guidance has been useful. We crossed some 100 odd people through the day, through the hour. So this is good. Thank you. Thanks a lot. And thanks everyone. Thank you guys.
Thanks, Ajay.